Hello students, as I already told you in our Zoom class, in the first few classes we will concentrate on the development of quantum mechanics. Okay, we will have a information about the brief history of how this the subject, a new topic called as quantum chemistry, came into picture. Okay, I already told you in our first class in the Zoom platform that this quantum mechanics was developed around 1900. So the theories, the collection of theories that existed before 1900, such as Newton's law of motion, Maxwell's electromagnetic theory, okay, so you had other topics such as optics. So all these collections of all those theories or rules or laws that existed before 1900, okay, approximately all those theories were developed before 1900, and the collection of all these theories is now called as classical theory. This is called as classical physics or theory. Okay, now it is called as classical theory or physics, which is based on mainly the Newtonian's law of motion and Maxwell's electromagnetic theory. And the new theory that we have after 1900 is generally called as modern physics. Okay, the new theories that were developed after 1900 is called as modern physics, which mainly comprises of special theory of relativity, which was given by Albert Einstein. Similarly, you have general theory of relativity, okay, which was also the sole contribution of Albert Einstein. And we have the third, which is quantum mechanics, which we also call as quantum chemistry. The application of quantum mechanics to chemistry problems, okay, so chemistry related problems is called as quantum chemistry. So we as a chemist, we call it as quantum chemistry. Who developed the quantum mechanics? It is not the contribution of single person. Okay, the quantum mechanics was initially formulated by Max Planck, who gave quantum theory. But this quantum mechanics, which is also called as wave mechanics, was developed by several scientists. Okay, it was because of the contribution of several scientists. To name a few, Schrodinger, Heisenberg, Dirac, Pauli, Born. Okay, so you have several scientists, even Einstein, who contributed to this development of quantum mechanics. So this is a very new theory that was required, which and were formulated after 1900. So the very first question that comes into our mind is, why do we require a new theory called as quantum theory? We will only concentrate on the quantum chemistry. Okay, these special theory of relativity and general theory of relativity are more related to physics, so we will only concentrate on quantum chemistry. So why do we require quantum chemistry? Why do we require a new law in physics or new law in science when we already have older theories which worked well? Okay, for that we should understand first, why do we require a theory in science or why do we require a theory in physics? The answer is very simple. Okay, any event that takes place in nature or any experiment that is done in laboratory, we as a scientist record the observations. Okay, we make some observations about the experiments that we do in laboratory or any event or phenomena that takes place in nature. Why that event takes place? Why did we get a particular result? Why did we get this particular outcome? To answer all these questions, we require certain theories or rules or laws. Okay, So the theories that existed before 1900, called as classical theory, was able to explain all the phenomenons that took place in nature, and also it was in a position to explain or answer the results of any experiment that was conducted in laboratory. Okay, but it was up to 1900 where it actually faced its first failure or first limitation. So, because of certain limitations of classical theory in explaining some of the experiments that were conducted around in and around 1900, a new theory was formulated called as quantum theory. Remember, it is not the complete failure of classical theory. Okay, there still this classical theory are correct in their own way till today, but they are not perfect, but they are not complete. They are applicable only for certain problems or for certain systems. They are not universal. They are applicable only for certain events occurring in nature. So remember, classical theory is not completely wrong, but it is also not completely correct or unified or universal. So that is why we require a new theory called as quantum theory. So which are those experiments, okay, that changed the way we look at nature? Okay, because by looking into nature, how nature behaves, okay, whether it may be microscopic system such as atoms or molecules or electron, or it may be macroscopic systems, okay, such as heavenly objects, that is the astronomical objects. So by looking into various natural phenomena, we formulate different types of theories. Now, which are those experiments that were conducted in and around 1900 which led to the failure of classical theory? So some of the experiment that classical theory failed to explain are, to name a few, black body radiation experiment. So this was the first experiment, the results of which could not be explained by classical theory. I have already told you to study what is black body, because I will not discuss what is a black body, what do you mean by black body radiation experiment, what are the experimental observations or results of black body. All those are not in the scope of our syllabus. These things you have already studied in your PU and first year degree classes. So I have already told you to study these topics, to learn these topics again, rehearse these topics again, and come to this class. So I am not concentrating on what is black body or black body radiation. I am only concentrating or touching a small part of this historical event, which will be helpful for us to understand what is quantum theory or why classical theory failed to explain black body radiation. So this is the first experiment with which it is, which is the first experiment which cannot be explained by classical theory. Similarly, we have one more experiment called as photoelectric effect. Okay, this also cannot be explained by classical theory to any extent, okay, to even a small extent. Similarly, you have other some significant experiments such as Compton effect, which I will not discuss here. You have heat capacities of solids. Heat capacities of solids. And even the structure of atoms. Okay. Structure of atoms. And in particular, the line spectra of atoms exhibited or shown by atoms could not be explained by the classical theory. Even though several theories were proposed to describe the structure of atom, okay, a satisfactory model for structure of atom was first given by Niels Bohr, who in fact used this quantum theory to some extent to explain the structure of atom, especially hydrogen atom. So these are some of the important experiments that cannot be explained by classical theory.
Let us first take the example of a black body radiation, okay, black body radiation experiment, and understand why classical theory fails to explain black body radiation experiment. So classical theory fails to explain black body experiment. What is black body radiation? The radiation emitted by a black body. What do you mean by black body? It is a perfect absorber of radiation, and therefore it is also a perfect emitter of radiation. Whatever radiation or light is absorbed by a black body, if that black body is heated to a particular temperature, it is the one which emits back maximum radiation. So the radiation emitted by a black body is called as black body radiation. So a black body is heated to different temperatures, and the radiations emitted by the black bodies, which means radiations of which wavelengths are emitted, and what are the intensities of the emitted radiations, they are recorded in the form of a graph, which is nothing but a plot of intensity versus wavelength. What is I? It is the intensity of a particular electromagnetic radiation that is emitted by a black body corresponding to a wavelength lambda. So you get a famous curve which you already know, okay, something like this. This is at a particular temperature T1, okay. If you carefully observe, okay, this curve, it is clearly understood that not all the electromagnetic radiations are emitted to same extent, okay. You have a particular electromagnetic radiation of a particular wavelength which is emitted to the maximum extent because its intensity is maximum. So there is a particular wavelength lambda corresponding to maximum intensity. So if you carry out this experiment at different temperature, you get similar curves, which I will not explain here. You get a different curves at a different temperature, T1, T2, T3, T4 again, and so on, where T4 is greater than T3, greater than T2, which is even greater than T1. So in your earlier classes, you have studied in detail what are the important salient features of this curve, which is nothing but black body radiation distribution. This is a distribution. Okay, this is I, is sometimes also called as energy density, E, energy density. Okay, it is also sometimes called as energy density. What do you mean by energy density? It is the amount of energy emitted per second in a unit volume. Okay, that is energy density versus lambda. So this is E versus lambda, which is nothing but called as a distribution. Okay, so this is a curve representing black body radiation distribution. So in order to explain this curve, why do we get such type of curve? Okay, why there is a maximum at a particular wavelength, why the area beneath the curve increases as temperature increases, why there is a shift in maximum wavelength to the left as we increase the temperature. So there are several important observations that are made in a black body radiation. To explain all these observations or results, okay, you require a theory. And what theory we had when this experiment was done? This experiment was done in around 1850, somewhere around 1850. So at this time, you did not have quantum theory. There was no necessity of quantum theory at that time, because the older theories, which is now called as classical theory, was able to explain all the experiments. So scientists were confident that by using Newtonian theory or by using electromagnetic theory, it is possible to explain black body radiation also. So in and around 1900, different scientists, okay, one of them is Wien. Similarly, two scientists, Lord Rayleigh and Jeans. Okay, so these two tried to explain this curve by using classical theory. Wayne separately, independently, he tried to explain. These two scientists together, Lord Rayleigh and Jeans, tried to explain this curve, that is the experimental observations of a black body, by using the theory that existed at that time, which is nothing but called as classical theory. Okay, so what does classical theory say? See, classical theory is very enormous. It is not just one theory. It is a pool or collection of several theories which was developed over 300 to 400 years. So let us only take some of the important observations or important points of classical theory. Let us take a gist of classical theory. According to classical theory, that is according to Maxwell's, okay, so these two scientists tried to explain black body radiation using classical theory. They tried to explain, both tried to explain using classical theory, but to their surprise, not only to their surprise, to the surprise of the entire scientific fraternity, they were not possible to explain, okay, how to obtain this curve completely over complete wavelength. Okay, it was observed that Wayne, who tried to explain this in a different way, he was only able to explain or get satisfactory result at lower wavelength. Okay, he got satisfactory result only at lower wavelength. What does it mean? If I take this lower wavelength region, the nature of the curve that is obtained here experimentally was obtained by Wayne theoretically also. So there was a theoretical fit between theoretical calculations and experimental results. So Wayne was able to reproduce this curve only at lower wavelength theoretically, whereas Lord Rayleigh and Jeans, who also tried to explain this by using some of the classical theory concepts of classical theory, they obtained equations using which they tried to plot this graph, but their graph did not fit into this curve. It actually fitted into this curve, but only at higher wavelength. So Rayleigh and Jeans, they obtained satisfactory results at higher wavelength. So using one, it was only able to obtain the distribution curve at lower wavelength. Using the other, it was only possible to get a satisfactory curve at higher wavelength. No single theory or explanation could reproduce the entire curve at all the wavelengths. So why they failed? Okay, for that we have to understand what actually classical theory says. So let us try to understand what classical electromagnetic theory says. Okay, what does classical electromagnetic theory says? Okay, this was given by a well-known physicist, Maxwell. Okay, his contribution to electromagnetic theory is very profound. Okay, he was solely responsible for developing this classical electromagnetic theory. According to his theory, the source of radiant light or radiant energy or an electromagnetic wave, is a vibrating or are vibrating particles or oscillators. So according to Maxwell, the source of radiant energy, that is electromagnetic wave, that is an electromagnetic wave is emitted, and what is the source for that emitted electromagnetic radiation or energy? The source is nothing but a vibrating particle, especially charged particle, a vibrating charged particle, which we also call as an oscillator. So if I have an electron, okay, if I have an electron which is oscillating or vibrating, okay, it is vibrating about its equilibrium position. This is the equilibrium position, which I have shown as a dot is the equilibrium position. So this is the maximum displacement of the electron from the equilibrium position, called as amplitude. And if nu is the frequency of oscillation, it means in a particular instant of time, say for example 1 second, this electron is oscillating to and fro how many times? Nu number of times. That is the meaning of frequency. So this is a charged particle. Electron is a charged particle and it is oscillating or vibrating. And any oscillating or vibrating particle, according to classical electromagnetic theory, should emit an electromagnetic radiation. So this emits an electromagnetic radiation. And the, okay, this is the mean position or the equilibrium position. Now the amplitude of this electromagnetic wave is same as the amplitude of this source, that is the vibrating electron. Similarly, the frequency of this electromagnetic wave is also the same as that of the source, it is nu. So these things you have already studied. So according to classical theory, a light is emitted, or an electromagnetic wave is emitted, and what is the source for that electromagnetic wave? It is a vibrating electron. Now let us concentrate on some important aspects this classical theory tells about this electromagnetic wave and this oscillating electron. Let us first focus on the energy, on the energy of the oscillator. Okay, energy of the oscillator. Now according to classical theory, according to classical theory, the oscillator can have any amount of energy. The oscillator can have any amount of energy. What does it mean? It means that there is no restriction on the amount of energy the oscillator possesses. Okay, there is no restriction on the amount of energy the particle possesses. Or you can also understand this it in a different way. It means one can change the energy continuously. Okay, so there are certain important points that you should remember. Okay, according to classical theory, that is our old theory that existed before 1900, the amount of energy that an oscillator can have, okay, is not restricted. Okay, it can have any amount of energy. There is no restriction on amount of energy the particle can have. What does it mean? It means that you can continuously change the energy of the oscillator. There is no restriction. Okay, for example, if the energy of the oscillator is 10 joules, okay, You can change it to 10.1 joule, or you can change it to 10.001 joule, or you can change it to 11.1 joule, or you can even change it to 25.111 joule, or you can even reduce, okay, it to 9.854 joules. So the oscillator can take any energy, okay. There is no restriction on how much energy the particle possesses. So you can change the energy of the oscillator as you wish, from 9.854 to 9.855 or 9.856. You can change it continuously. So this word is very, very important. You can change the energy of the particle continuously. This is one of the important concept or idea that we had about the energy of the oscillator. The energy of the oscillator can be changed continuously. There is no restriction. The second important idea about the energy of the oscillator or the subsequent electromagnetic radiation that is emitted, because the energy of the oscillator is same as the energy of this electromagnetic radiation, because this is the source, this vibrating electron is the source for this electromagnetic radiation. So the second important idea what we had, okay, earlier about the energy of the oscillator is the energy of the oscillator or the electromagnetic wave that is emitted by this vibrating oscillator, okay, the energy of the oscillator does not depend on the frequency or the wavelength, okay, of the radiation or the vibration. So this is an important idea or concept that we had about the energy of the oscillator or energy of an electromagnetic wave. The energy does not depend on frequency or wavelength. According to classical theory, there is no much difference or distinction between energy and intensity. They were treated almost one and the same. So casually, in classical theory, we call sometimes as energy of the electromagnetic radiation, or we may sometimes say intensity. So both the words are used loosely, casually, okay, almost thinking that they are meaning one and the same. So according to classical theory, the energy depends on amplitude. It is actually, energy is directly proportional to the square of the amplitude. So these are the some of the important assumptions that we had in classical theory. So according to classical theory, what is the source of any electromagnetic radiation? It is nothing but a vibrating charged particle, is that is an oscillator. And the electromagnetic radiation that is emitted by this vibrating electron, its amplitude and wavelength is same as that of the vibrating electron. The energy of the oscillator, and therefore the radiation that is emitted, okay, for about that you have to remember two important points. One is, the energy of the oscillator can, okay, be changed continuously. The oscillator can have any amount of energy. So there is no restriction on how much energy the oscillator has. You can change the energy continuously. What does it mean? When you are changing the energy of the oscillator continuously, it means when this oscillator is vibrating and as its energy is changing, numerous or all possible type of electromagnetic radiation will be emitted. What do you mean by all possible type of electromagnetic radiation? Electromagnetic radiation of different wavelengths and different frequency will be emitted to the same extent. Okay, so the probability of an electromagnetic radiation of higher wavelength to be emitted will be same as the probability that a electromagnetic radiation of lower wavelength will also be emitted. Okay, so the third important point that we have to take from this classical theory or classical idea is that, you know, that there is always an ambiguity about the nature of light, whether light is a wave or light is a particle. Okay, according to classical theory, light behaves like a wave. Light is a wave. To be more specific, according to Maxwell's electromagnetic theory, light is actually an electromagnetic wave. Okay, so these are the three important ideas of classical theory. The important ideas of classical theory, which were used by scientist Wien as well as the other team, that is Rayleigh and Jeans. Okay, both the teams, okay, they used this idea of classical theory to explain black body radiation, but unfortunately both were unable to explain the results of black body radiation completely. Both were successful partially, one at higher wavelength distribution, the other at lower wavelength distribution, but both could not give the complete picture of black body radiation. So at this stage, Max Planck, okay, he thought that in order to explain the black body radiation, that is in order to obtain or reproduce the distribution curve that I had shown in the previous slide, okay, one has to deviate or break away from the classical idea. That is, this is the classical idea that I have written here, a gist of the classical idea. So Max Planck thought that in order to explain the black body radiation experiment, we have to deviate from this classical idea. And he thought that the nature does not work, okay, according to the idea that is laid down by classical theory. The nature works differently. So he proposed an alternative theory which is almost against this classical idea, which he termed as quantum theory. So in the next class, we will try to understand what are the important ideas of this new theory called as quantum theory, and see whether using quantum theory, Max Planck is able or not to explain black body radiation.